What is up, everybody? Welcome to IGN Game Scoop. You'll see some different faces here this week. I'm your temporary host, Sam Claiborn. Welcome to spooky season, everybody. Game Spook. It is October, and I am joined in this spooky episode by Justin Davis.
Scoop.
Our Starfield reviewer and review master, I think that's his official title, Dan Stapleton.
Something like that. I'll take it.
Mm-hmm. And then our managing editor, Rachel Weber, is back. Welcome, hello. Rachel. Hello, hello. So Damon is in Hawaii, just having a terrible time, I'm sure. It just must be just awful being in Hawaii right now. Now, he's probably having a better time than us, but not better than you, because we've got a great show for you today. We are going to talk about the big Starfield DLC that's out. How big is it? All the new games we've been gaming, extracurricular activities, including maybe some spooky movies and shows. Ooh. And games, because it's that time of year. But first, that's right, we're doing a but first. There's a PS5 Pro Anniversary Edition out. It costs $1,000 or more than £1,000, actually, I think, in certain areas. The big news for me is that it has a reseller proofing going on in Japan. But let's talk about this big boy first. It's $1,000. Is anybody getting one, first of all?
No.
Because some people get more excited about the PlayStation Pro once they saw this anniversary gray-looking PS1 version. Rachel, you get it?
I love it. I am a PlayStation girl through and through. I cannot justify spending that, but I wish I could.
And we're all the target demographic of this, the people old enough to remember what the original PlayStation looked like. I have to imagine like the kids probably don't care that much.
Yeah, I think so. But it did hook a bunch of people at IGN immediately. I don't think anybody got one because of what we're about to talk about with how difficult they were to get. But I can tell you why it's $1,000. So you're kind of seeing it right now, what it looks like. It actually comes in a bundle. So the bundle, I'll read off the description. It says this: the bundle comes packed with a special version of the PS5 Pro console and awesome accessories that feature throwback design elements and a legacy color scheme. And by the way, the color had a U in it because I believe I'm reading a press release from Europe that pays homage to the legendary original PlayStation console, which launched on December 3rd, 1994. Each limited edition PS5 Pro is for sale. For sale is individually numbered as a collector's item. I don't really know how they do that. I wonder if they do like a stamp on the side of it or something like that. And there's 12,300 of these numbered consoles globally. So in the picture, I was like, what's going on there? There's like a weird disc thing. And I was like, oh, does it come with a disc drive? No, it doesn't. It comes with a limited edition. I'm just going to stop saying limited edition, actually. It comes with the PS5 Pro console, a DualSense Edge wireless controller, another DualSense Edge wireless controller. So two dual senses, a charging station, a console cover for the disc drive. That's the round thing. So if you get the disc drive, because remember the PS Pro doesn't have one, then this like covers it up and makes it look cool next to it. It comes with a vertical stand, a bunch of normal stuff. And then you skip to the bottom, there's stuff that I didn't actually see, which was in here, which actually makes me a little jealous. So it comes with an original PlayStation controller style cable connector housing.
That is the one I love. That is the absolute... Yeah. I love
that. What do you think that is specifically?
I mean, flat boy? Yeah, it has to just be the kind of like, you know, the old plug-in. Because they show it briefly, but it just, it reminds me so much. It makes me so happy.
Yeah, it just kind of coats the controller cable in a gray coat with a big wide thing at the end, I guess. It's really funny. It says four PlayStation shapes cable ties. So even your cable ties are branded. A PlayStation sticker, a limited edition PlayStation poster, which I hope says now you're playing with power or something like that. Cool. Like Nintendo used to have posters in their consoles. And then this is the number one for me. Are you ready for this, y'all? A PlayStation paperclip.
Ooh. Oh boy.
Just the one? You just get one.
Yeah, just the one.
I hope the poster is like the polygon head, the pink polygon head with like the spiky sticking out of it. No, I That's mean, look, one. Like we, it was 2 weeks ago on this show, we were pretty down on the PS5 Pro. You know, I wouldn't claim to have done a complete 180, but like this console is gorgeous. Like it's amazing what a different coat of paint and different kind of colorway can do for the design of something. Like I think, you know, Sam, you and I are both on record as thinking, you know, the PS5, I think it looks really dumb. I think it's a really, really dumb looking console.
But yeah, this fins.
Yeah, but this gray and this slightly different kind of shape to it, like the PS5 Pro is a little thinner than the base PS5. like it's gorgeous. Like, it's completely turned around my opinion of like the aesthetics of the console. I am not interested in buying one for $1,000 US, but at least they've made something that's kind of like, you know, crave worthy. Or as you said, like, I'm definitely going to be jealous of the folks that did manage to snag one.
And to be fair, like that, like $1,000 is not much of a premium for all the stuff in that, yeah, in that bundle. Like the base console is what, 700, and then the PlayStation Portal is another 200, and then the controller is 70 usually, and then another 30 they charge for that base. So, and then all the extra stuff you get on it is just gravy, I guess.
I guess just throw on the disk drive, and I'd be more happy.
And the paper.
Does anyone here have a Portal and use it?
Mark Medina does, and he swears by it. He played all of Astro on it, which is nice for like writing a guide, you know?
Yeah, I don't have one, but I know like the way that I play games is like sometimes, not always, but sometimes I'm sitting in front of my television, but I would still rather have my Switch in my hands playing Switch games that way. Like, I'm just a little bit, I don't know, I'm just used to it. Like, I like that form factor. And so I think if I did have a PS Portal, I think I would get good, great use out of it, but I haven't picked one up.
I have to admit, that's one of my favorite ways to game. Yeah, just like on the couch with a TV show on with my Steam Deck, just grinding something.
But you don't have the Portal?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, if there was, if the PlayStation had the most, you know, I guess single player experiential like games out right now that of any system, like they have had in PlayStation history, they just don't really have that going for them right now. I don't need to play 10 games in the PlayStation this fall. Sometimes that happens. It's not happening right now, so I can't see a purpose for one. So everybody here said $1,000 is too much for them. What about $5,000? Would you pay $5,000 for this? Because that's how much the aftermarket wants already for it. I mean, that doesn't mean they're selling for that much. I always want to correct articles that say this. It drives me crazy. It just means that's what idiots have listed them for on eBay, right? That's all that means. When they start selling, we'll be able to see an average of what people will pay for the premium over the $1,000, which it could be like $1,300 or something. That's the PS5s. They were going for like $900 when they were, what were they, $600? They were like $300 bucks over. So like, you know, it's, I'm not saying that's a good thing. I'm just saying there's going to be some kind of markup on the aftermarket, which is why our article says, as spotted by Automaton, the Japanese PlayStation homepage confirms that anyone who wants to pre-order the PS5 Pro 30th Anniversary Edition in Japan has to, and remember, you could pre-order this through an official site, like not on Amazon, stuff like that. You go through a PlayStation site. They did this for the PS5, I think, for the first time. I might be wrong about that. But it says in Japan, you had to meet the following conditions. You have to have a PSN account registered in Japan and have at least 30 hours of PS4 or PS5 runtime on the account between February 2014 and September 19th, 2024. I think this is awesome.
Yeah.
I love this. I want them to do this at, you know, Ticketmaster to do this for gigs. You have to show you've listened.
Exactly,
to
Rachel. That's exactly
at least 10
it.
Times.
It'd be cool if you could do that. I was thinking, how do you do this for tickets? And like, yeah, what if you had like when you bought a vinyl copy of something or bought the Apple Music version, it came with like a redemption code.
I need a receipt, you know? Or I need like to see it on your kind of, you know, Apple Music or something.
I think it's really smart. I mean, I think, you know, it's not like, look, this is 30 hours of gameplay over a decade, right?
PS4 so included. It's cool.
Like, and it's not about gatekeeping at all of like, aha, we only want our hardcore fans getting this. Like, it's to combat bots, right? Like, you know, bot accounts that are just trying to scoop up the, you know, not real gamers. They don't want grabbing these consoles. And so I think that's really clever.
Only real gamers should be allowed to buy them and post them on eBay for $5,000.
Yeah, maybe it should have been like, maybe they should have had like a ladder of like only like people with 1,000 hours of game time get in at this time, and then people with 5,000 hours get in at this time.
So there's that housing we were talking about.
Then they'd be getting it to the people who need it the least because they already have all the hardware. Like, how about a bundle with two more controllers when you've already got them.
I mean, time was you had to wait in the rain in November outside of a big box store to even get a console to resell, you know, and like I never thought I'd be pining for those times. But like bots and internet sales are a real problem for tickets and for hardware. And I think this is a really cool way to solve it. Maybe there could just be an apportioned amount of these for, you know, each territory or something like that. And then there, you leave the Amazon sales and stuff to, you know, bot stuff. But it's a problem. And like, even like, I guess like, you know, registering a credit card and stuff like that, like none of that seems to be working either. It's just, I don't know what's going on, but like this, I want to hear if this worked, and we never will, right? We're never going to hear how slow they sold in Japan.
I mean, I think these things are going to be really expensive. 12,300 is not very many at all.
Worldwide.
They could have easily in one day have sold five times that many. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's like, it's like legitimately rare.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I think the next big hardware push is going to be the Switch 2. And I don't think Nintendo will take any precautions to sell the Switch 2 or do anything special with it. But like, I legitimately am worried about being able to find those for not just for myself for playing, but for like staff for work, you know, it's difficult.
Well, just visit IGN, follow IGN Deals on Twitter and subscribe to the IGN Deals newsletter. And then we'll make sure we'll let everybody know where the Switch 2 is available.
I wonder how much the PlayStation 1 themed Switch 2 will cost.
You know, I do love it when Nintendo retro themes their systems. They haven't done anything like that for Switch so far, but those are
I need a translucent one. I need like...
Oh, yeah.
That would be amazing. I'd buy that instantly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Translucent really like, plus a color is always fun. Purple or green or something like that.
Yeah. The new Xbox NES... Elite controllers, you can choose colored transparent plastic. And I'm
no way. I didn't see that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's back.
All right. Anything else, Justin? We kept cutting off there.
No.
Okay. I'm good. All right. So let's move on to talk about Starfield. Again, we have the reviewer here, and maybe by the time you're hearing this, we will have a scored review. So I think Dan can talk about that. This goes up late on Friday. And then also, Rachel had a special assignment to play a little bit of Starfield, and we'll talk about some other games too, but I couldn't find a lot of people on staff playing Starfield. So really appreciate you both showing up to talk about this, because I'm super curious about it. And Dan, I'm going to start with you. Is everything fixed?
I mean, they fixed some things. I mean, but that's largely patches outside of the DLC.
What about the fun? Did they patch the fun with this?
if you're enjoying, if you enjoyed Starfield, and I enjoyed it, I did not dislike this game. Common misconception. I liked it explicitly, said I recommended it in the review. That apparently was not enough for some people, but I enjoyed playing it, and I continue to enjoy playing. You know, I played this for 12 hours, it says. What this is more story content that, you know, fills in a gap it felt like they very intentionally left in the main campaign, because
mention that. Did it feel like they held this back, or did it feel like it was indeed additive? Like, that's a weird situation, right? Where you're like, why didn't this faction have their faction quests?
Yeah, I mean, it felt... it feels different enough that it's not just more of exactly the same thing, in that once you go to the Varun homeworld, you can leave, but you never have to. Like, you every quest there is self-contained, so it feels much more like a traditional Bethesda world, because you can you know, walk from point A to point B, and there's more than one thing on that map that you can get to without fast traveling that is like actually handcrafted and interesting and not just procedurally generated filler.
It's not geographical anomalies all the way down.
Right. So that, and I don't even know if I don't
geological. I can't remember what it was.
I don't even know if I've seen one of those.
One thing about Starfield is that we were hoping that this would be Bethesda with, you know, space exploration, space battles, but it turns out Bethesda is more about the planet side in this DLC iteration. So they didn't kind of go all out on boarding spaceships and space battles and stuff like that. Like, I was hoping that would get expanded more, frankly.
I mean, they call it shattered space, so it was reasonable to expect some space, but there is no space whatsoever. I think the only feature I found for if you're interested in spaceships and in this expansion, the only thing I found is that there's now a legitimate place to buy Varun ships instead of just stealing them from zealots who attack you.
Okay. So Rachel, let's go to you for your impressions. Tell us where you're at and how many bugs you've killed.
I've not killed that many bugs. I've killed a lot of floaty, teleporty
ghost
enemies,
geeks.
Which which, as we all know, is everyone's favorite enemies that teleport.
yeah, whiz robes.
It took me a little while to get back into it, actually, because I'd fought pretty far in Starfield, and then I must have got distracted by something, because I was about level 40. I'd done loads of the kind of main quest stuff and then just walked away. So the first problem going in was kind of, it was a bit like coming back after a vacation or something and walking into an office and being like, what the hell was I doing? Because I was halfway through a mission that I couldn't remember. My inventory was a mess. I was carrying like 17 potatoes and no ammo. So that was the first problem, just like getting to the Oracle spaceship, which is what starts your mission. And then I have warmed to it now, but the first thing was just getting used to all those kind of little Starfield quirks again, like the kind of all the oxygen level thing where, oh no, you can't run now because you're carrying too many things. And so
I was going to bring up inventory. So that's like the carrying an inventory. So that's not like changed, it sounds like, but didn't they do some inventory system things? Like it's easier to see your stuff when you're moving things around or in shops. I just remember like the inventory was somehow inferior to games that they put out 10 years prior.
No, the inventory is still the same. They may have made a few little usability tweaks, but like, that's still a sore spot for me. They've added maps. Thank you for that.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that.
Mm-hmm. They've added the car. Those are both big improvements, but they have not fixed the inventory system. And Rachel, I totally agree with you. It took me, like, I'm glad I started playing to warm up for this, mid last week, because it took me a while to find my space legs again. I had forgotten a lot about how stuff works.
So you both just went to like a pre-completion save and started from there?
Yeah.
I went to the save that was like right before I went through the Unity and went through it, which is effectively going into New Game Plus. And then did just a couple of things. I did the Mantis mission, and I did like a couple of temples, and I grabbed Sarah from the constellation and then just ran right into the DLC.
It would be funny if you'd come back to your game and you're like, why is everybody a child? Because that was one of the permutations of the New Game Plus. But
I would love if they had done something like roguelike-ish, and like every time you go through the Unity, it changes something weird like that, but not really.
I mean, they do a little bit of that, right?
A little bit, but not like a global modifier.
Mm-hmm. I think the story is like interesting. I don't know how far through it I am, but I'm often kind of having to. It's very Game of Thrones. There's lots of different houses. You have to do like a different task for different houses that get more complicated to kind of bring everything together and follow the main story.
It's a cult story. It's about the religious zealots, right?
Yeah. So there's a lot of slow walk. It's apparently a slow walking cult, because at the first bit where you have to do the ritual to kind of join the cult, there's a lot of just following a guy who, if you get too far ahead of him, he'll stop. And if you stay too far behind him, he'll also stop. So there was a bit of that. And there's kind of a bit where you do all the ritual that was kind of like a bit, wasn't as fun as I think they thought it was. But once I started getting into more of like the little emissions, like trying to solve an argument between two dueling brothers who want to kill themselves, things like that, I am enjoying that more, the kind of weirder little stories. And that reminds, and that's when I start feeling the Bethesda love again. I just wish they'd gone a bit weirder.
Well, in terms of weirdness, we're talking about these like teleporting enemies and stuff. There was nothing strictly, I don't think, supernatural about the Starfield universe. They kind of explain things with physics, right? Are they still doing that? Or are they just opened the floodgates to being like, there's another dimension? And like, is that how they're explaining stuff? Basically, the interdimensionality instead of like ghosts?
No.
Dan will know better than me.
Yeah, not really.
Like, so right now they are. They're kind of like, it's science or it's God. That's the thing.
Right. So there's the inherent conflict between religion and science, and they have characters that kind of are representing both sides of that coin in their theocratic society. It never goes like super deep into that. It's not an interdimensional story. And they're not the phantoms that you're fighting are not ghosts. I kind of like where the story ended, like, or at least the reveal of what the big experiment was that went wrong. that caused all this destruction. Like half of their main city was destroyed and is now just this big crater. But I kind of like where they went with that. It takes a long time to get there. It is very long-winded, as you were saying, Rachel. It's a very, you know, political story about these three factions within House Faerun, which I guess is like the umbrella house, and then within that there are these three competing factions, and their leader has gone missing, and so they're you know, having a little power struggle.
I will say absolute genius on the part of the game designers. Oh, there's been a tragedy. Half the city has been destroyed. So, you know, we've just got this small bit of city for you to walk around and go to the store and explore things in. Don't worry about the rest of it. That's gone.
I will say, like, it is a little bit odd, like, how kind of pristine the surviving half of the city looks. It doesn't really sell the, like, this is a disaster zone thing for Marie, even though that's, like, all anybody's talking about. Is, you know, they apparently had like a Thanos snap level of casualties out of this thing, just like people right in front of you being gone. But it looks, you know, like a nice city most of the time. And it does look like nothing else they've done in this game. It looks almost alien, even though the Varun are human under their, you know, tattooed faces and what we do in the shadows accents, but they are just humans who have sequestered themselves off.
The lighting in this sequence looks really good, and then a lot of it's in anti gravity. It's like floating.
Not apparently. A lot. Just the okay. opening area. You land on a space station, and then after like what, an hour or 2 hours, you go to the home world, and you turn the gravity back on. So I kind of like what they did with the gravity, the zero G sequences, because they have those blue glowy walls you see in the footage. And, when you shoot, you're being launched backwards, you know, by the recoil of your gun. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. and if you don't realize there's one of those behind you, when you fire, you get launched into it. And then, it hurts you a little bit, but it also teleports you a little bit. So it's kind of disorienting. It's just something to be aware of.
Okay, so what's your verdict, Dan?
There's a cheeky trash compactor bit that I liked as well when the gravity's off. I don't know why, but that's the weirdness I like. You just go into a room that's a trash compactor full of trash bags, and it's slowly closing, and you have to get out of there quickly.
And all those trash bags are floating, and then you turn the gravity back on, that everything falls. So fun little physics moment. So yeah, overall, I'm giving it a 7, which. I do think it is generally, you know, well done content, just more stories content. It's just kind of unambitious. It is in a lot of ways, it's Bethesda playing the hits, right? A lot of the main quests it sends you on are, you know, find the fugitive and decide if you're going to, you know, kill him or help him fake his death, that kind of stuff. So it's all stuff that they have, almost all of it is stuff they've done before. And, you know, they put a little bit of a spin on it here to make it, you know, Starfield flavored. And that's enjoyable and interesting. And it certainly has its moments. And I do like what they did with, making this planet feel more like, you know, less procedurally generated, more to do in that one zone. But there's no like Dragonborn kind of thing where you can fly, you can ride a dragon now, right? Once you leave this place, there's not much you'll take with you to the rest of Starfield. So it doesn't have the kind of refreshing effect that something where it's like, oh, you go in there, like you didn't even get like a special Varun, power that you could use. So there's nothing.
Interesting. I was wondering if they'd like upgrade your magic because you went to, you know.
No, there's none of that. There's no new skill tree. There's no new systems or anything. It's just new story content. And if that's not doing it for you, it's like Starfield wasn't really lacking in story content. There's a lot of it there. But it's good if that's, you know, what you're after, but it's not going to, if you weren't into Starfield before, you probably won't be into Starfield now.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. I was going to look up the price. So it looks like $29.99 is the price for the standalone DLC. Although I believe some editions of the launch edition just included it. Was there like some sort of season pass or something like that?
Yeah, it was the deluxe editions came with it.
The deluxe editions. Okay. All right. Any other thoughts, or can we want to move on to other games we're gaming?
Is it gonna get either of you guys to want to play it?
Justin? No, and I also didn't remember until we were recording this show that I got roped into, like, I'm sure millions of gamers, maybe not millions, thousands of gamers, that like Starfield was out 3 days early if you had the deluxe edition.
And so
I had Game Pass, and there was a deluxe edition upgrade of like, buy this upgrade, and then if you have Game Pass, this is what you need to buy. And so I mostly bought it to play the game early, but it's like, oh yeah, I also have this DLC. So, you know, I'm not super interested in playing it right now, but I don't know. Like, I thought Starfield was fine. So, you know, like, and again, it's on Game Pass, and I like Xbox Cloud. So, you know, maybe I'll go back to my saves, but it's not compelling enough for me to like kind of stop what I'm doing and get into it right now.
They have your money. You just have to decide if they can have your time as well.
Yeah. They already got what they wanted.
I will say that I'm glad it brought me back in there to try it out with the enhancements that, you know, the new maps, the new car, the new, you know, minor quality of life fixes.
Right. That's what I'm most interested in.
Yeah, and just like the ability to and they patch this in, the ability to, you know, see a piece of food on the ground and just eat it right there instead of having to put it in your inventory and then go into your inventory and eat it. Just things like that make the whole thing a lot smoother. And like that much like, you know, usable maps and a good inventory are things that they had in previous games. And, you know, they're slowly bringing that in.
Although, did they have munchie mode in previous games?
Yeah, Fallout 4 had that.
Cute.
One thing that's weird is you can only eat food from the ground, not from tables or plates. I don't know why they won't patch that in.
Only floating food.
Yeah.
Frozen floating food. That sounds painful. To wrap up Starfield, we talked about price. We're good there. Okay, so let's move on to what else we're playing. Justin, you had a game your family's been gaming.
Yeah, me and both my daughters are playing Zelda separately. We actually haven't had a chance to like sit down and you know, play together over the shoulder gaming yet. I love it. I think that Tom's review is exactly right, where I think that the game, how it demos and how it presents itself, is a little bit of a Zelda kind of side story or spinoff, but it's not. It just feels like the next Legend of Zelda game. And the more that I play each evening, it sort of like reveals itself like an onion and just gets kind of bigger and bigger in scope until you're like, wow, like this game is really big. And, you know, and the story, I'm intrigued by like where that's going insofar as I can be in a Zelda game. Like, it's still not an incredible story. You know, I agree with our review where it's very, I'm still many hours in, not used to not being able to attack. I keep wanting to say that it's clunky, but clunky is not the right word, but just like, I just like that urge of like, there's an enemy and I just want to attack the enemy. And like, I'm still not used to like, I just have to pull out, you know, some Pokemon or a guard or whatever and have it fight the enemy for me. Like, I've not quite gotten over that yet. But it's so good. I mean, you know, everything that everybody said about it, it takes some of the best features of the old school, you know, top down Zelda games. It is a little bit more linear, like go here, do this, go there, do that. But then gives you just complete freedom and trust in the player to like, this puzzle doesn't have a solution. It's just a puzzle. And then you're going to invent your own solution and get past this obstacle however you want. And, you know, right from the opening moments of the game, oh, this B-roll is very well timed, but like right from the opening moments of the game, it's like you can sequence break. Like, you can be climbing around on the tops of trees and stuff like that. And the game just like lets you do that. It's great.
Hey, what are your top three most used echoes right now?
Definitely number one is the bed. The bed beams are real. I still am using that. I don't remember what it's called, the little floating spinning plant thing.
Yeah, the pea hat.
Yeah, the pea hat. That's what it's called. I don't know what my third one would be. Those are the two. Those are like my go-tos. Probably
the trampoline if you're using the bed a lot right now.
Yeah, trampoline plus bed is a good combo.
But your fighter is the P hat right now. That's what we're seeing right now.
Yeah, correct. Okay. Yes.
Okay. I suspect that once you get some other easier to deploy, more kind of common Zelda enemies, you're going to start using those and start forgetting about the sword a little bit then, because it's like there's certain ones that, like, yeah, as soon as you, and this is a cheat that I put on our cheats page actually, you can drop certain echoes and they attack right away, but then they take a little while to recharge their attack, and so, yeah, you just spawn them a second time. You just keep on running around your enemy and putting them, and they swipe, so you drop it, they swipe, and then you go behind them and you summon that one back and drop the other one, and then you just attack. Feels really good. Love that, yeah, stuff. And then you get, of course, different transitional elements like we're seeing right now, which is a little bit of a spoiler. That one's really great that we're seeing right now. I'm still playing Zelda as well, and I have nothing to add except for I'm deep into the side quest side of things, and there's just so much. It's just unrealized, yeah, as you said, the onion keeps unraveling. And like, you don't need the stuff you get in them, but it's all unique at least. Like, you want to get all your heart pieces, right? You want to get all the collectibles that are tracked in the game. But like, there's like, yep, tons of outfits and items. And like, I have a huge inventory of stuff that I'm building. And like, I only keep this one thing equipped ever. I can equip like four now, but like, I keep this one set equipped. I'm never going to switch to the other ones. You know, like, it's a little silly, like how much stuff there is. And like, there's hard boss fights, but you don't need 20 hearts and four fairies. Like, you would never need that. That's overkill.
Yep. I agree with that. No, I'm so pleased with it. Like, I almost wasn't even interested in, you know, like, oh, I'll save this game for Christmas. Like, I'll play it a little bit later. But it was my daughters that were like really like begging to play it. And so, that's
so cute.
Yeah. And so I'm so glad that like I chose to play it now. It's like, if someone is like me and they're looking at it and they're like, oh, I don't know, this feels like sort of a side story. Sold. It's like, I wouldn't wait.
I'm going to buy it tonight now, because I've been holding off, but yeah, hearing you talk about it, and I love the way it looks.
Mm-hmm.
I love the style.
Yeah. Did you play Link's Awakening?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that game is a really self-contained, wonderful game. And this is just so much far beyond that. Like, it's just really neat to see like, whoa, they kind of made a port and they tested some things, and then they're like, we're gonna make the real game next. You know, it feels so diminutive compared to this now. But Rachel, that's great. So we made you play Starfield for a few days here, though, so you were unable to catch up on Zelda. That's okay. What were you playing for fun before that?
I was dabbling in Warhammer. I'm not good at it. No one's ever gonna want me on their team, but I just love being in that world. I'm very like, I'm a Warhammer admirer. I've never played the games. I do want to start painting the figures, but I love the lore, and that game just looks amazing. So I'll go in and get beaten up just so I can look at some things. Dan got me playing Frostpunk 2, nice, which is very bleak. You have to play it in short bursts, really, because it's very depressing, and I feel like harder this time around. I don't know if I'm just rusty, but yeah, I feel like I've got a lot more starving happening. And there's an adorable indie called Lightyear Frontier, which is kind of like a farming crafting sim, but with like little mechs.
Stardew in Space, we all called that when it was first shown.
Yeah, and it's so much fun. It's just had a big update. So I played it in the kind of early access when it first came out, and it was just a joy to hang around in, and very colorful and fun. But like, it was kind of limited how far you could go up the progression ladder of, you know, new things to craft and stuff. But it's just
how is this on Steam Deck?
Oh, it runs great on Steam Deck. I'm not even sure if it's verified, but it runs perfectly.
Okay. This is a must play for me on Steam Deck. I think I'm going to switch over to that.
For Frostpunk.
They just added pets.
For Frostpunk, as far as, you know, it versus the original, like the original is kind of much more of a a linear strategy game. Like there's kind of a narrow path you have to walk in that one. This one is a little bit more open, a little different in the approaches you can take. So it's because of that, it's more complex and a little harder to wrap your head around, I think. But they're both very good in very different ways. And I said in my review, I think the original is much better at kind of an intimate feel, where you get to get, you know, a better sense of, you know, you can kind of see your people walking around just on the streets as you play. Whereas this one, you kind of have to zoom in super close to get a sense of it, but a sense that, you know, they're actual people in your towns. but it's a much grander scope. You're, you know, zooming in and zooming out and, on a from a town level to like the civilization level, basically.
It is a sim above all.
And it's a city building sim, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, Dan, you told me about this a little while ago, but it's been one of the most wishlisted games on Steam for years, and then it debuted, and it's not a high player count on Steam. There was some sort of audience flight from two, at least. Is that what happened?
Well, like I said, it's a very different game. So I think a lot of people came to it expecting it to be an iteration on that first idea, when it's really an entirely different strategy game set in the same world. So it's very mechanically different. So a lot of people, I think, were disappointed that it wasn't the same, but I think it's not. I don't know if I would. I gave it an 8 as opposed to, I think the first one's a 9. Mm-hmm. So I think they're both very good games. I think the first one is arguably better. But, you know, one thing that I really enjoyed about it was, like, I went from replaying the first one directly into playing the second one, and I didn't feel like I was retreading the same ground. They're both interesting in the same ways, or in different ways, rather.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's it. It's, if you're, you know, I played a lot of the first Frostpunk, and I think it's almost, you kind of go in expecting to be like, I know what I'm doing. Like, come on, let's build a beautiful, warm, toasty city for everybody. And then, you know, you're having to kind of make a lot more decisions, like Dan says, on a much bigger scale. It's a lot easier to make mistakes that you can't really, you know, things just start, the dominoes start falling, and that's it. Everybody's dying. You can't bring it back.
Oh my goodness.
And I think that can feel a bit frustrating when a game is, you know, a sequel, and you think, you know, I don't need to learn anything. I can just go in and start playing, because you really do need to learn a whole new system of building, at least, and what's important. So I think people like me, who sort of had a bit of a tantrum when I first tried it, will go back, because that's what I did. I sort of started playing it, went, I just keep dying, and like walked away, and then came back.
Do you think it's suffering because of Satisfactory? Like, this is scratching the same itch as Satisfactory for people, or do you think that's different audiences, and that's a bad assumption?
Those are very different games. There's no supply chain mechanics in this at all. Like, I barely.
There's not. Okay.
Yeah, and it's like, you can like convert one type of fuel into another, but it's not. And I guess you do convert basic supplies into, or materials into, goods, but that's it. Like, it's only one tier of transition.
I honestly think what's hurt is the two. I think they would have been better calling it, you know, like Frostpunk Journeys or something. I think the two meant that people who didn't like the first one have no interest in checking this out, even though, you know, the changes might have made it for them. And the, you know, people who loved the first one and bought it and found a pretty different game, I kind of, you know, a bit grumpy about it. So
yeah, or hear me out, Sim Frost, right?
Ooh.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, the two kind of makes it like the worst of both worlds, right? It's like, it's a very different sequel, so fans of the OG are like a little bit disgruntled, but then if you didn't like the original, then you're disinclined to check out the sequel.
And not a Justin game.
Oh no, this would definitely be a Justin game.
Oh, it is. Okay.
I don't. The original Frostpunk is on Mac. I don't have a PC at the moment, so I would have to figure out if it can run on a Mac, which the original Frostpunk can. And I did play, you know, like a couple hours of it, and it was good. And then I bounced off it, but it would very much be a Justin game for sure.
Okay. Yeah, I think it looks great. I think it looks completely engrossing, and I wish I had this, you know, extra 2 hours in the day for a 26 hour day, so I could play Sim games. I they all look appealing to me. I just have to let Dan play them instead. It's really sad.
As my daughters are playing Zelda, they're peppering me with questions, like, but they're farther than me, which is really tickled both of them. And they're like, you're farther than you, Dad. And I'm like, well, you don't have to make dinner and then load the dishwasher and work, you know. They're probably playing
you
right
are
now.
You have to stay up later than them, though. So
that's a good point.
You should be throwing Satisfactory in their faces and be like, listen, every day I have to pump out this much.
The conveyor belts won't, you know, they won't array themselves.
Have you had the spoiler talk with your girls yet?
No, and they also don't. They love spoilers. So like, please tell me how this ends. Like, tell me what happens. Like, they're playing through all three Zeldas at once right now. And like every day, she's like, just tell me what happens at the end of Tears of the Kingdom. I'm like, no.
I mean, I know that's true because we have huge statistical article traffic to all of our spoiler pieces, and like. For however much people, and we don't want to spoil games on our homepage or put spoilers in front of people, but the fact that they're out there and people can look them up is just, I know it seems surprising to people that are anti-spoiler, but boy, there's a lot of you that are not. I'd say the vast majority.
You're like me and you're getting older and you watch so many films and play so many games that sometimes you just don't remember what happened at the end and you just need 100%. To go back and check.
Mm-hmm. Yep. We, as my older daughter is 10 and she's like, last night at dinner, she's like, Dad, did you know that there's some people that they play video games and like record themselves playing the video game. And then they try to play it really, really fast, like as fast as they can and record that and like put that online.
You had to speedrun talk.
I was like, and like, you know, like she's waking up to the world. So I'm trying not to give her a hard time, but like in that, I'm like, you know where I work, like, you know what I do for And I'm like, yes, sweetie, I'm aware that that's a thing that people do. And she's like, oh, that's so cool. I want to do that. Mm-hmm. So, and I said, no, but maybe when she's older.
I love that answer. The kids love that answer. Maybe when you're older. All right. So before we turn to our game of games, let's talk about extracurricular activities right here at the end of this Lord of the Rings season. I think it's crappy. So I can't wait to watch the last episode. Did anybody watch the last one yet?
No, you're the only one.
Okay, good. Okay. Then I'll wait till next week to talk about that because I was just taking planes. I took four planes and on each one, I watched a spooky season movie. And here's my short list, and Rachel can back me up on some of these and argue with me on others, but I definitely want to hear what people should be watching as we go into October and what you're all watching. So we have Lisa Frankenstein, which I loved. It's a great movie about teenagers resurrecting, kind of a Frankenstein plot, but Lisa Frank, you know, the cosmetics for girls in the 90s plays a heavy part of the style of the movie. It's really funny and really well-paced and great, and I just love everything about it. Hopefully it's a cult hit. The actors are all so funny in it, and it's a great just like kind of teen gore comedy. There's a lot of gross stuff in it. Same with Beetlejuice times two. A lot of gross stuff in that movie that I liked. I already talked about that one on the show. So those two are great. I saw The TV Glow is on the opposite end of that spectrum. I hated that movie. I actually stopped watching it with 10 minutes to go, which is like a really bad sign when you switch something off. I couldn't hang in there.
The ending's good as well. The ending kind of almost pays off.
Yeah, see, that's why I will read the Wikipedia entry. Yeah, exactly. I'll look up the ending because I just had to switch. I had to like palate cleanse. I was on like the fourth flight of four. I was so tired. I was just like, I cannot finish this. And it's such a good idea. It's about like an Are You Afraid of the Dark show that kids watch and they get obsessed with. It's like half Twin Peaks, half Are You Afraid of the Dark or whatever. But it's handled like there was a quarter of a script that was stretched across. Like butter across too much bread, right? Doesn't work. People talk very slowly in it. And then First Omen, okay. It's a good one. It's a scary movie. I don't like Catholic-based horror just because I think it's kind of boring and hacky. But this was a good one. You like that one, right, Rachel?
I love this one. Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that it went like some darker places, I think. And her name is insane and I can never remember it.
Oh, yeah.
The lead actress. She's got an incredible name. Justin.
She does, yeah. Mm-hmm.
What?
Do you know what it is?
No, I don't. Yeah, I don't like spookies.
Someone will be shouting at the TV.
But, Justin will be the palate cleanse at the end of the spooky discussion because he's definitely not watching any of this stuff.
Nope.
But what did I miss? What are the scary things you recommend this fall?
Well, I've actually got a list because there's so much good spooky TV coming. So on Hulu at the moment, there is Ryan Murphy, who usually does American Horror Story, has essentially done American Horror Story, but he's not calling it that. It's grotesquerie. Really? It is a police procedural.
I like it.
Sadly, Sam, there is a religious, very heavy religious murder situation happening.
Because werewolves? I don't understand.
It's, you know, there's lots of, it's people being killed in sort of weird ways that could possibly point to, you know, various religious passages, but it's really dark. It's very gory. It's got a kind of almost like, cannibal vibe.
I want to qualify. I like it when it's like vampires and stuff. I don't, I have no problem with this. I just, sometimes I'm just like, yeah, if it's like really like, oh, the church versus the cabal, or like, I just think that's like so old now. I just don't like it anymore. It just gets a little boring.
Yeah. I think this is inventive enough that you wouldn't mind it. So that's definitely worth checking out. That's already on Hulu. Salem's Lot is on Max tonight.
That's new, right? That's just debuting
tonight.
That's
a new adaptation. I think reviews have been a little mixed, but it's vampires, so we'll watch it.
Stephen King? Is that a Stephen King thing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. VHS Beyond. VHS is an incredible anthology series. They do kind of little shorts. And actually, IGN alumni Alana Pierce is in one of the VHS Beyond
action
shorts.
Really?
Yeah, that's going to be on Shudder this month. There is Hysteria, which is coming to Peacock. That's a satanic panic metal band supernatural horror series. See, we're getting really, really spoiled. And then there are a couple of like more kind of like wistful horror, kind of a bit more kind of neutrals and calm and less cool. But there's one called Teacup on Peacock, which is kind of a weird. A family are on a farm and strange things start happening. They haven't revealed a lot about it because I think it's one where there's, you know, there is going to be a twist. But that looks a bit gentler if you want something scary but not gory. And if you are missing Sarah Paulson, who is usually in Ryan Murphy's American Horror Story stuff, she is doing one for Hulu called Hold Your Breath, about a woman who believes her family is being sort of persecuted, hunted, it's unclear, but by an evil force. So there's so much good horror right now.
Poltergeisty.
Yeah. So
okay,
there's plenty.
That's a great list.
You don't have to leave the house.
I love it. But you should, to be healthy. What are you watching, Justin?
We started watching Sunny on Apple TV Plus. It's become such a meme that like Apple TV Plus will pay millions of dollars to get like an A-list director and actors together to make the most incredible shows and just not tell anybody about them.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that meme is like a little bit overblown because there are, you know, there are advertisements and posters and, you know, things for these different shows. But Sunny, I had literally never heard of.
I haven't.
And it stars Rashida Jones, who I really like.
She's the best.
She is the best, and it's really good. Like it's sometimes a thriller and it's sometimes a dark comedy. So like the tone of it is really interesting and quirky. And the premise is that she's an American living in Japan and her husband passes away and he worked for this kind of shadowy robotics company.
It takes place in Japan.
Yeah.
Oh
and now
my God.
And it's very Japanese too. Like it's very prominent in the show.
Awesome. Look at that robot.
And so her husband, like, yeah, there's this shadowy robotics company, and then his death is kind of mysterious, and she's kind of trying to investigate it, but she's also very sad because, you know, he's dead, and then she has this interesting relationship with the robot that talks, and the robot's voice acting is really good. Like, it's a very Sam show. It's a very me show.
Oh, my God, it really
is. And, like, some of them, like, you know, Bad Monkey and some of the other stuff that, like, oh, nobody's ever heard of this. It's like Apple did advertise those. This one, like, completely flew under the radar.
Dude.
And, like, it's great.
Oh, I can't wait. How
did
you even hear about it?
I found it browsing. Like we were just like looking for something to watch.
Wow.
Maybe someone in the phones division was like, hey, could you not do the thing that's slightly sinister with an AI whilst we're trying to launch this phone, please? Thanks. Just keep that one quiet.
Yeah, maybe they had to quell the AI panic. That's great. Dan, what have you been extracurricular experiencing?
Oh, Starfield made sure I'm behind on everything right now, but I have been watching all the shows. I've been watching the Lord of the Rings, which I'm two episodes behind
you
on
are.
That. Yeah, I'm two episodes behind on it. I'm okay with it so far. We'll see how that goes, which camp I end up in.
It has orcs in it.
Yeah, I'm behind on the Penguin. I'm behind on Agatha. But
I'll totally watch Agatha. Speaking of Halloween season, like I'm looking forward to like the hangover afternoon or something, in which I can just catch up on all those, you know?
Yeah, I enjoyed the first two episodes of that show. So I'm looking forward to catching up on it. And my wife and I are steadily binge watching our way through Hacks, which we had not really heard much about until it won
Rachel, what is up with you? You like that too, right?
I just started it. I got absolutely browbeaten about it by another member of the IGN team. Like, you'll love it. It's so you. You'll love it. And I started watching it begrudgingly, and I do love it. So
explain.
It's just incredibly well written. Yeah. So she is a kind of a young writer, loses her job comedy writing and sort of ends up having to write material for an older, slightly difficult, but sort of amazing, incredible, older actress, comedian who does a Vegas residency. So it's two worlds, two generations coming together. They really don't like each other to start with.
Awesome.
I'll let you guess whether or not that relationship falls a little bit, but it's just really, really funny. It's just, you know.
Good suggestion. Snappy. I love it.
Yeah, it's one of the funnier shows I've seen in years, and we're just in the first few episodes of season two. Season one was amazing, but I hear it only gets better. So
awesome! Yeah, a couple seasons in already too. I'm shocked. Again, where was the show when I needed it? I'm so happy it's around. Okay, that brings us to Video Game 20 Questions. So before I get into this, everybody remember how to play? Yes or no questions? You get 20 of them.
Weapon. I think Dan has the right mind.
Could be. It goes back way far back in time, so that helps sometimes, right? And sometimes it doesn't. I'll be able to, I think, answer everything, but I might have to stop and look up something. But this one is from Tyler in Midlothian, Texas. Mm-hmm. And let the questioning begin. He has a little story I'll read after this, too, about it.
Oh, we can't have any of the story now?
Well, it's going to be so redacted. It says
that's fine. Let
me do this. It would be, the reason I nominate it is because I feel like it's the redacted. helpful clue for you all.
That is heavily redacted.
A game that a fellow in Texas thought about is your clue.
Got it. Okay, did this game come out in the 70s, 80s, or 90s?
It certainly did.
Oh, man.
Good.
All right.
Did it come out? Did you just say, oh no?
Yeah, my memory is very recent. I play so many games that old ones get pushed out.
Right.
Did it come out in the 90s? Do we have any hope of this?
Confirmed. 90s.
Okay. All right.
Nice. Okay. Phew. Was it originally released on a 16-bit console?
No.
Ooh. That's interesting.
Is the kind of main hero person you play as, character you play as, human?
The answer to that is yes, but there's not a main.
Is the developer still in business?
He's having to look it up, so it's not a big one.
I'm not looking it up. I'm just trying to determine like what I'd say yes or no, but yes, it is. That's five questions.
Is this game multiplayer?
Absolutely.
Do you shoot?
You don't shoot.
I'm assuming... Some character can fire a projectile, though.
I'm assuming you get shot,
or perhaps you do not shoot.
Okay.
Are we thinking? And this is not a question, Sam. I'm conferring with my, you know, feels like a fighting game.
Yeah, I'm assuming it's a fighting game. That's why I asked if it was multiplayer. Did this game originally come out in arcades?
No.
Oh, but not on 16-bit consoles either.
No, and I'm going to count that as a question. No, just kidding. No,
just to clarify.
So that means probably not fighting then, huh? If
it didn't come out in arcades, I mean, it seems less likely.
Did Tekken come out in arcades?
Yes. Did this game originally come out for the PlayStation 1 or the Nintendo 64?
Yes.
Hey. I mean, it's probably the Nintendo 64 then, right? If it's multiplayer. But it's not GoldenEye, because you do a lot of shooting in that one.
And you mainly play as like a human, right?
Yes.
I did not own an N64, so you guys may be on your own here.
Did this game originally come out for the N64?
No.
Oh,
that's 10.
I didn't own an original PlayStation either, so you're on your own here.
So PS1 games, multiplayer. You play as a human, but there are other characters. Well, presumably, just the way that Sam answered it.
There's no main, he said. So there's a group situation.
I mean, so okay. So like,
is
it
sports game?
Yeah, there's like sports games, there's racing games.
Do you want me to answer one of those?
Well, just give us a second.
Things makes me think almost it could be like a football or a tennis or a...
Is this a sports, racing, or fighting game?
No, it's not.
We knew it wasn't basketball.
If you asked that in a very different, very slightly different way, it would have been yes, but it's not.
Why?
We know it wasn't basketball because you do all kinds of shooting in basketball.
That's good.
Like Parappa and like just anything I can think of that's a not fighting multiplayer.
Yeah. Why would the answer be different if we asked the question in a slightly different way? What does that mean? Oh, no.
I'll try to remember to explain at the end of this horrible, horrible cycle.
Yeah.
Is it because you said sports or fight? No. Sports or fighting?
Maybe it's
Could
sports.
It be sport fighting?
Sports and fighting.
Like a boxing game?
I don't think...
Because you throw punches, you shoot...
Yeah, I'm not sure you'll be able to crack this one. I'll explain it. It's pretty interesting.
I don't think Sam would do that to us. So hold on. So, okay, let's reset here. So PS1 has multiplayer. You play as a human. It is not a sports fighting or racing game. And you do not shoot.
Could it be like a car combat game? Is that Twisted
Metal?
That's
actually pretty good. Twisted Metal's a pretty good answer. Or something like that. Destruction Derby. Yeah, car combat game. Do you spend a
lot
of time in the
How many questions do we have left?
You have 11. You've asked 11 questions.
Has it had in the last 10 years, like a remaster and a re-release?
No.
Do you spend a lot of time in a vehicle in this game?
Yes.
I think you are onto something there, Dan. Although I would say that there's a lot of shooting in Twisted Metal, but not in Destruction Derby. I don't know how to narrow this down in an intelligent way.
there's some big questions that we always ask on this episode, although I don't know if all of them would be super helpful.
Yeah. I also don't know who made many of these old car, like, car vehicular combat games. Is one of the mascots of this game a weird, creepy clown?
You know it is.
Yeah. All right. It's one of the Twisted Metal games. I mean, is this the first game in a series?
Yes.
Is it Twisted Metal?
Yes. I got it in 16 questions.
I think I got it a little earlier than that.
So here's a couple things. So
I told you Dan was a secret weapon.
He's got to ask it, though. He's got to ask it officially. You did a great job, Dan. Twisted Metal, you don't do the shooting in Twisted Metal. Your car does, right? What? I didn't know how to answer that. And like, not all the cars are about that. A lot of them are just about ramming, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know. Like, that's a tough one. If you would ask if it was a driving game, it is. It's not a racing game.
Yeah, the racing game thing, I completely agree with. But the shooting thing, it's like the car is shooting, you're not shooting. Like, dude.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't call Gradius a shooter. Do you shoot in this game?
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. Well, we got there in the end, so no need to send this one up to the commission.
No, I hear you. It was a tough one. So IGN gave this a 7, and in the review, which is like three paragraphs long from 1996. It says like, it's so weird playing a game that's about driving a car, but it's not a racing game. And I just thought that was really funny. I mean, Mario Kart had been out by that time, right? It's just strange. But yeah, it's from 1995, November 1995. Here's a weird one. Everybody, I'm so happy you didn't ask this. Console exclusive? Technically, no. So it did get ported to PC, which it was shown at CES. And there was a very limited commercial release on PC in Japan.
Weird.
Which has like an incredibly rare run that, you know, people desirably search after. So like that could have thrown everything off, right? So very lucky you didn't follow that default.
That's what console exclusive means is on a console and PC.
That's true. I guess I would have said, yeah. We always ask it that way too. So that does make sense. You do shoot. I'm watching this car shoot right now too. So yeah, those were problems with the questioning. I admit. So there's no new games in production for this. It was also close. The reboot happened in 2012. I know that's not a remake, but still 10 years. Rachel, you asked within the last 10 years, it's 2012. So yeah, we always say that. There hasn't been a Twisted Metal since then. Can you believe that?
There's been a TV show.
I know. It's crazy. Yeah. Well, nicely job, everybody. You got it. And yeah, some of those difficult games, one of them I'll give you was an NES game called Super Dodgeball. Would anybody got that?
Maybe.
Maybe. I like that game. I think maybe with us teaming up, Jess, we might be able to get that. But that was one of the harder ones. There are some hard ones that I got submitted. But thanks to everybody that submitted that. Here's the little story. The reason I nominated it, Tyler says, is because I feel like it's the most glaring admission from the latest Astrobot. I kept hoping that some of those characters would show up at the crash site and also see what Team Asobi would come up with in terms of Twisted Metal inspired level. Isn't that true? I mean, that's crazy that there's no Twisted Metal in it. Yeah, went on to ask a good question that we can't make it to this week, just about like what other properties were not in Astrobot that could be in DLC. And I'm just shocked to hear there's one this big, frankly. I think they drilled so deep. And we did talk about some of these like Vib Ribbon and stuff like that in our previous episode that could be in there. Okay, let's wrap this one up. That is all the scoops we have for you this week. Thank you, Justin. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Jobert, working behind the scenes to make this episode possible. Damon will be back from his vacation next week. So thank you to you all for listening. This is IGN Game Scoop, and we're out.